and thank you for coming. It's a cold, cold day, and I'm very glad to be here. Obviously, this is not my normal place and position, but Ms. Marilyn asked me to be here and to do this for y'all, and she's just for her. The first thing I just want to say was that when she asked me to be a part of this, I said, "Really? You really want me to do this?" And she said, "Yeah." And I said, "What am I supposed to say?" She said, "You'll come up with something. You'll come up with something." I said, "Spoil." And she said, "You can do it." And there was a tone in her voice that said, "Yes, I'm going to do this." So in the process of doing all this, we were the other day, we were doing some things with services, and as Doug was going through the little things, they had to fill out all the forms, and they kept saying, "The deceased, and the deceased, and the deceased," you know, at the end of it, I looked at Marilyn and Doug, and I said, "Deceased, so I'm going to give between deceased and past." And I'm like, "What are you asking? Is it deceased and past?" I said, "I don't know whether you realize it or not, but people say when they pass, and sometimes they say, well, they died, they deceased, whatever. But deceased means that your body died, but your spirit passed. There's a difference in the two, okay? And, you know, whether you realize it or not, if you're trying to figure that out, you say, well, what do you mean my spirit passed? Well, you know, you can't, if you think about a spirit, you can't choke it, and you can't stab it, and you can't shoot it. That means that your spirit lives on. It's eternal, right? And if somebody comes along and says, "You religious people, what do you mean your spirit? Prove me that spirit." And if you think about it, we're all human. We're the human species in here. Every one of us, we're a human body, but yet we are all basically the same. The only thing that's really different about us is that our personality is what's different. And the personality is what we in the religious area, we call our souls. And you know, when I'm looking at you, I can detect you with my five senses. But when I am, when I try to determine your personality, I can't detect you at all. I can't smell you, I can't taste you, I can't taste you, none of that I can. And if I can't do that, then that means you have to be something more than a physical being. You have to be something more than just physical. That means you have to be spirit. And if you're spirit, then that means you have to be passing on to the next level, next spiritual world. So if you're a spirit, then that's where we're going to go be. And of course, according to the Christian faith, you're either going to be in the spirit world, you're either going to be with God, or you're going to be without God. And you have to make that decision as a spirit. And so, for those of you that aren't quite sure which direction you're going to go, then you can talk to us about that. But I think most of us in here know where we're going. But at any rate, if you need a religious lecture this morning, that's about as far as it's going to be. Okay? Now then, I do have a story to tell you, and this one has to do with Sarah, obviously. And Sarah has passed on next, and she's not dead, she's alive. And so Sarah has some little characteristics about her, and when Marilyn said, "You can do it," that was Sarah coming out in her. Okay? Well, Sarah was the type of person that once she finally figured out what she wanted, she knew what to do to get it. And so I had a little story one time where I was going over to her house, and she asked me to cut this tree down in the backyard. And so I brought everything over there. And while I'm getting there, I said, "Well, okay, Sarah, which one is it?" And she points this tree in the backyard over there, and I think it is a really pretty tree. And I'm looking at it, and it's like 15 feet tall, 15, 20 feet wide, and it's just balanced. It's a picture postcard, this kind of picture. It's so pretty. I said, you want to cut that tree down?" She said, "Yeah." I said, "That's a pretty tree." She said, "Well, it needs to be cut." And I said, "Well, you're going to let her do that?" And she says, "Well, you know, my mom, when she gets set her ways, you can't change her." And It's not my tree anyway. You know? And so I said, Sarah, I said, this is such a pretty tree. I said, well, what kind of tree is it anyway? That's a palm tree. I said, okay. So it's not producing any fruit. I said, but Sarah, this is a nice tree. You wouldn't look, if you're like most people, you think you're going to do a lot of those plums? But all you're really going to do after the first year is just look at them, and they're going to fall on the ground and make a mess. I said, you got the best of both worlds. You got the trees, you got a beautiful tree that does not produce the fruit, and therefore it's pretty. You don't want to cut this tree down, I promise. So, if it don't produce any fruit, it's not any good to me. And I looked at her and I said, no, I said this joke anyway. And I said, when's the last time you produced any fruit, Sarah? You know? And I said it in a light tone, in a nice tone, you know? And Marilyn, she kind of grinned about it a little bit, and Sarah grinned about it a little bit too. And I said, Sarah, this is such a pretty tree. It's just hard for me to cut this thing down. Now, I should have stopped right there. And I should have just gone and done what she asked me to do. Okay? But I thought, one more stab, one more chance. I said, Sarah, you know, when Jesus went to the fig tree and it didn't produce any fruit, well, he cursed it and it died. You know, it wasn't long thereafter, he was gone too. You sure you want to cut this tree down? That's when I said, okay, I don't know if I should have said that or not. And I looked over at Marilyn. Marilyn's, her eyebrows were about this high. Her eyes were like saucers. It's like somebody's picture of buttons hanging on to it. And she all of a sudden had this little nervous twitch. I look at her, she's going. And so then I thought, okay. I said the wrong thing. I said, look over at Sarah, and she gave me the other one eye. I don't know if y'all know Sarah, the one-eye look. That's what she did. She gave it over one eye. And I said, oh my goodness. I hope she opens up that second eye, because if she doesn't, I'm in trouble. If you ever got the one eye with Sarah, you knew it was time to redeem yourself, or you're going to be in trouble. So I immediately okay, so I'm just kidding, y'all. And you know the next thing I did? I cut that thing down. But that was like Sarah. Sarah, she knew what she wanted. She wanted to get it done, and she was sweet, and we loved her, and we were fortunate to be around her and to have her, and she blessed our lives, and hopefully we helped her too. With that being said, let's see if I got green next in mind. Marilyn asked me to read some verses, and the first verse, or the first chapter, and y'all are going to recognize it as soon as I started. But I'll need to introduce it just a little bit. In the 12th chapter of this of Corinthians, Paul is talking about all the gifts of the Holy Spirit and how they are just wonderful, and your followers, and you're going to have these gifts, and you're going to be able to do miracles. Healings and all the things that we would all just think are wonderful. And right at the very end, the last thing he said was, but earnestly desire the best gifts, and yet I show you a more excellent way. And you're like, wait a second, you just told me that I can do things like miracles and all, and you're going to tell me now there's a more excellent way than that one? And he did, and this is what he proceeded to say. Though I speak with tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I have become surrounding brass and or a clean cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understanding and all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I can remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I have given my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. It is not puffed up. Does not have behaved rudely. It does not seek its own. he is not provoked, thinks no evil, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. But whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part, and we know prophecy in part. But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I am still as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I am now, known now. And now by faith, hope, love, these three, but the greatest of these is love. And I think that's what Sarah was, she was that kind of person. The other thing Marilyn asked me, she said this was at her mother's funeral. We've had these verses, and of course, she thought Sarah might have these same verses right here. Who can find a virtuous wife? For her worth is far above rubies. The heart of her husband safely trusts her, so he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not evil all the days of her life. She seeks wool and flax, and willingly works with her hands. She is like the merchant ships, she brings her food from far. She also rises while it is yet night and provides food for her household and a portion for her maidservants. She considers a field and buys it. For her profits, she plants a vineyard. She girds herself with strength and strengthens her arms. She perceives that her merchant is good and her lamp does not go out by night. She stretches out her hands to the steel, to the staff, and her hand holds the spindle. She extends her hand to the cord, yes, she reaches out her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of snow for her household, for all her household is clothed in scarlet. She makes a tapestry for herself, her clothing is fine linen and purple. Imagine that. Her husband is known in the gates, when he sits among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them, and supplies sashes for the merchants. Strength and honor are her clothing. She shall rejoice in time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue is the law of kindness. She watches over the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also and praises her. Many daughters have done well, but you excel them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is passive, but a woman who fears the Lord shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own words praise her in the gates. A cousin of ours, her name is Letha, and she has written a letter that she asked me to read. My name is Letha Kvistad Hartley, niece of Sarah Edmonds. Joe Edmonds was my mother's brother, therefore giving the Edmonds family a loving gift, Aunt Sarah. I can't remember my first recollection of her. She was always there. Aunt Sarah was easy to love, sweet, considerate, and loved her family. But don't mess with her kids. Terry, son of Joe and Sarah, was 2 years younger than myself, but could fight like a wrestler we watched on TV. For some reason, he wouldn't leave me alone. So I made a pact with a friend of mine, Tootsie Moran. Tootsie. We planned to get Terry upstairs at our Green Acres Baptist Church. Not really very thoughtful. Tootsie was waiting on him. I coached him up to the primary department. He was a little reluctant. Once there, Tootsie got a hold of Terry, leaving room for me to lay a few punches. We won the fight, but not long. Aunt Sarah didn't punch me physically, but I was truly ashamed after she finished with me. A loving mother and a wife she was. Not only did she love her children and her husband, but she loved her entire family. After having our twins, Chad and Brad, it was very difficult. There were many special friends and family who came with a loving heart to help, Aunt Sarah was the one who truly gave up herself unselfishly to our little family. She was always there when I needed her. Our babies were premature, requiring much attention. I could never repay the nurturing love she gave all of us. I love Aunt Sarah, so thank you for all the things you taught me with your sweet spirit. I will miss you, but we will see you one day. I have wonderful memories until then. Love, Letha. Sarah lived a good life. She was a good mother. She did all the things that were held responsible for her, and she carried out the good fight. I'll always hurt. Is there anyone that would like to say would like to say anything? I think the graveside, we aren't going to have a graveside service. It's just too cold. But is there anyone that would like to say anything else?
I will say something just to get it started. Talking about you can do it. When she was in the hospital, she knew I was going to go out and get some lunch. And she said, she called me over and said, I want you to get me a Dr. Pepper. And my response was, I don't know if you're supposed to have that. And she said, you can do it. I said, you mean you would send your only daughter out to break the rules? And she said, yes, you can sneak it in here. I know you can. And she got a doctor.
And most of the time that you can do it could be interpreted as you will.
She was real sweet, but she did have her ways. She did. And she let you know. She wasn't like you didn't know exactly what she wanted. She let you know what she needed to do. Well, is there anybody else?
I know where all that fruit went from that tree.
Oh, you do?
So, Marilyn, you may not know this, but I have a recurring memory of going to Joe and Sarah's house on Halloween. And trick or treat, we always have cute costumes as kids, and we would go to all of our families, and Joe and Sarah were the only people that would put in our candy bag fruit. And I always wondered why we went there. But they wanted us to be healthy, I guess. Apples, oranges, never is it zero. And plums, I'm sure.
That was a pretty tree. Anything else?
I might say that I always enjoyed seeing Miss Sarah at the First Baptist Church. I'd sing in a choir, wouldn't be close to her or something, but when I'd walk down or something, she always had that little smile and was always glad to see you. I also served as a veteran service officer. She and Marilyn would come into the office. She knew what she wanted to do. She knew what needed to be put on the paperwork. It was just my job to put it there like she wanted it there. And it was always a pleasure to work with her.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
Let's just close in prayer, please.
Can I say something?
Sure.
Just thought of a memory of me and my brother Jake when we were kids. We would always, you know, stay over there every few weekends and with Marilyn and Grammy, football, and we would flip the rubber mats that had the little spikes on the bottom. In the middle of the night, she would come out. In the morning, we cooked breakfast, and we'd be all happy and step on them things. And next thing you knew, we'd be picking a switch in the backyard. All day long, but one of my favorite memories. So.
She takes you back, right?
Well, she got it, yeah, but it was a constant warm. That's great.
And Father, thank you for the life of Sarah, and that she still lives today, and we look forward to seeing her and being with her, and times she was a light in darkness. And we'll miss her, but she's not gone. We ask these things in the name of Jesus.